mission today. Get up right now on your feet and let's go to it. Right now, get up, let's go. Hey, 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 you ready? Hey, 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 hey. I'm not a sinner, I'm a saint. I'm a saint. Days of Jesus, all of my world's gonna see this. I'm not broken, I am saved. Watch the way out of brand new identity. He lives in me. I'm pure, I'm clean. I'm not who I used to be. I got a brand new nation. Creation. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Come on, just sing it out.
Jesus is here.
sing at the throne of grace. At the throne of grace, we boldly come to you. Our hands lifted high, we believe.
God's goodness in our life today. We're not just screaming an empty praise. We're not just shouting to a God that doesn't exist. Today, we speak to the Lord of Lords, our Savior King, King Jesus, who can rescue you from every single need possible. But the only way that you can access God right there where you are is if you lift up a voice of shout unto Him. This is why we are shouting. We're not just screaming. We're not just clapping hands. The only way that you can receive from the Lord is if you have faith. And we know that we only have faith if we can praise God regardless of our problems today. That's why we declare that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So I want you to just raise up the name of Jesus. Before we come and usher, before we come and we minister to you and we pray to you, we need to have the, we need to be at a great place of faith within our spirits. So when I count to three, I want you to really raise up the name of Jesus. I want you to worship him as your King of Kings, as the Lord of Lords. Can you do that? Come on, let's do that today. One, two, three. Let's raise up the name of Jesus. We raise you. There is nothing like you, Jesus. Today we give you all the honor, all the praise. You are holy. You are worthy, Lord. Today, with everything that we are, we worship you. We declare you our Redeemer, we are friend, our Prince of Peace, our mighty banner. You are Jehovah, the beginning and the end. You are El Shaddai. Everything that we need is in you. And we worship you. We worship you. We lay aside all struggle, all our pain, all hurt in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen, amen. And right there, just close your eyes. And maybe you've had a difficult couple of weeks. Maybe you have sensed that you're distant from God. Maybe there's a need that you have in your life and you want God to supernaturally work in your life. The Bible says in the book of Mark 11 verse 22 that if you come to God and you ask that you have received with everything that you are, he will give to you. It says that you must have faith in God. And today we're going to come with everything that we are and we're going to pray to the Lord. And today, won't you just make your request known to God and just start praying unto him. If there is a need in your life, just start speaking to the Lord right there where you are. Start speaking to God and say, God, I need you in my life today. God wants to work in your life. Each and every single person that's joining us via streaming, everybody who's here in the auditorium, God wants to work in your life, but you need to pray unto him today. We are praying unto you, Lord. Father, you can see your children. Father, you can see their need. You can see the hurt. Father, you can see the pain. And we thank you that you are a compassionate God. Thank you that you said when we come to you with faith, asking you and knowing that we believe it, we will receive it in the name of Jesus. And I pray for every single person here. I thank you that the blood of Jesus speaks louder than any curse. The blood of Jesus speaks louder than any stronghold. And right now, we rebuke the devourer in the name of Jesus and we render him powerless right now. Every sick body is healed right now in the name of Jesus. Every person struggling within their academics, you give us the providence that we need. You give us the wisdom. We give us everything that we need. We thank you right now, Lord, that you, regardless of what the need is, you work in every single person's life. And we appropriate that victory in the name of Jesus. And won't you just start thanking, Lord? You don't have to shout. Just start appropriating your life. The Bible says that if you have the vision, you can see it in your life that God will do it for you. Just start seeing God doing a miracle. If you couldn't walk, I want you to stand up right there and walk. If you couldn't see, I want you to open up your eyes. If you are failing, I want you to see your distinctions. If you are poor, I want you to see the riches of God coming and pouring in. I want you to see it with your mind's eye. And if you believe that Jesus has done it, won't you just give him a big shout of praise? We raise you up, Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. We lift up your name. Yes. We worship you. And as we're about to close, I want you to just close your eyes again. You know, Pastor Caesar speaks about in his book that the moment you receive a miracle, there are critical key elements after that, which is you not allowing the devil to steal that moment. You not allowing the devil to steal that miracle. I'm not just praying here for those who have a need. I'm praying for those who really know that they need Jesus in their lives. I don't want you to walk out here thinking that we were just screaming, we were just shouting, but I want you to seal it with a praise within your life. If you were really struggling, I want you to see with your mind God doing the work. And I want you to confess it with your mouth and say, today is the last day I have that struggle. Today is the last day I have that stronghold. Today is the last day I have that argument in my life. I want you to receive it from the Spirit of God right now. God has done the work in your life. Now you can go walk in your freedom. in the name of Jesus. And everybody shouted together, amen and amen, amen. Amen, amen. You guys may take your seats. All right, we're so thankful for the Lord who's received a miracle. Amen. Just give Jesus a bigger shout of praise right there where you are.
Hallelujah. 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 Is there any better place to be than right here at the Vault Live? We have a very, very, very special service for you. But before we get into that, we're just going to hear a word from our generous sponsor, Clientele Wife.
Dr. Love is proudly sponsored by Clientele Wife. If you need a wife, we've got you covered.
Hi, I'm Desmond Tobe, and I'm with Clientele Life. With Clientele Life, you can get over 500,000 rand life cover for only 250 a month. Yes. Even when you're dead, you still get paid. I joined Clientele Life after I died, and they gave me 250 rand airtime to call all my loved ones to come to my funeral, your wedding, your funeral. And they also gave us a free poker and 2 free chips. So, bye, thank you, Clientele Life. Yes, you had it for yourself. Even our premium cover covers for your whole family. Literally, Zungu will be premium cover yet. It covers you for your whole family. You even get a lump sum. I don't even know what the lump sum is, but you'll get it 2 times. And you'll always get paid when you're dead. You get airtime when you...
This has been Clientele Wife. Enjoy the show.
Today we have a very, very special guest. Why don't you introduce yourself?
I'm Chase from 3C USA. So shout out to my USA fan watching. I sent the link. Everybody's tuning in. So shout out.
We're so glad that 3C USA could join Dr. Love on the Vault Live. Now, Chase, you sent me a very, very impactful video. And just roll the clip one time.
Yo, what's up, Vault Nation? I'm Chase from 3C USA, and I don't have a special friend. I don't have a wife, and I need Dr. Love's help. And I kind of don't know how to,
My man, how are you, Chase? You good?
I'm good.
All right, from USA, right?
Yeah.
So you and the African wife, man. An African wife. So Dr. Love, you're going to sort him out, man. It's about that time.
Maybe. We'll see. We'll see.
Uh-huh. African juju.
I have to hear from Dr. Love.
Now, Chase, Dr. Love and the Love Band had to come out of retirement for this. This is a very, very big issue. It's a very, very big deal. Just share your heart with me real quick.
On love?
Let the heart speak, my brother. Let the heart speak.
If she has a visa, you know?
Chase, would you like some water? Chase, a wise man once told me that in the desert, even bitter water can taste sweet. See, Chase, what you need to understand, my brother, is a lot of times as a man, you get thirsty. There are so many men in USA. There are so many men in Africa that are thirsty. And now you're in the motherland where the heat is. So when you are in this desert, it is easy to get thirsty. But here's the problem with being thirsty. See, when you're in the desert, you settle for the first bitter drink you get. And then you wake up one day and you ask yourself, why is my attitude so bitter? Why is my discipleship so bitter? Why is my relationship so bitter? It is because there is a point in your life when you were thirsty and you settled for the bitter drink. The Bible says you gotta drink from the living water. If you are not drinking from the living water, your drink is bitter. So some of y'all have been drinking from a bitter fountain. Some of y'all have settled for a bitter drink. Don't let your thirst take you away from the life of the living water. Oh, you're still here?
I'm still here.
Chase, don't get me wrong. We have so many amazing women in this beautiful country. We got chocolate, we got vanilla, we got the mix in between. See, God, there's a reason why God rested on the seventh day, because on the eighth day, he created the women of Africa. But I just want to encourage you, Chase. I know you may be thirsty at times, but you need to drink of the living water. Drink of his word. I don't know where you find yourself today, but you got to drink of the living water. And we have such a great service, such a great lineup for each and every single one of you. We got Euphracia, they'll be sharing the word. We got the Love Band. There's no better band than the Love Band right here. So make sure you keep it locked. We have the Josh in the building. Killer mix, you don't want to mix it. But before we get into that, we're just going to show you last week's highlight clip. So, Lokwa Kutsa Sok Fambana Man, Uwa Tzwele Kuru Fambana, The Vault Live right here on The Vault TV. Love Band, play me out.
Get ready to turn up with Jesus today.
If you're not on Twitter, just raise your hand. So you're all on Twitter. Is that so? Oh, when we're gonna ask you if you're about to tweet, you're gonna say, I don't have Twitter. I don't have it. Oh, the guys watching. After a month of struggle and pain, of trying to climb to Division 1, we've made it to Division 6. If you know, you know. You've been getting a free house and learning how to do your makeup. Dude, makeup. Have you ever heard of Dr. Dove? It's the sound of a dove. A dove that's in love.
My life is nothing but a comedy.
Brother, plug and play, let's go. Yo.
Good evening, everyone. thankful to the Revolt team. So thank you so much to the Revolt team for making this happening, and the Vault.
Are you not ashamed of yourself? Are you not embarrassed? This is really embarrassing.
That's gonna be on next week's highlight clip, isn't it?
Oh, praise God. Aren't these highlights clips just so hectic? They're so funny. I wonder who makes them. But anyways, good evening, guys. How you guys doing? You guys good? To those that are streaming, I hope you guys are also doing good and that you're excited and that you're ready to get into the Word of God. I am so privileged. Wow. Guys, this is technically my first sermon, so I'm like super blessed. I've gotten a whole lot of support, people hyping me up, getting me excited for today. So I'm so excited to share it with you guys, and I hope you guys are ready. This is something that God has personally been speaking to me about, so I hope that God will really speak to you about this as well. But I'm excited. Before I get into it, really, I want to honor God for this opportunity. Like I said, I thought, okay, Lord, it'll probably take time to even get here, but really my dream has ever been to minister, to teach, to preach, to heal, as Pastor Bert has been teaching us, and it's really such a privilege to stand. And yeah, thank you to my pastors. I'm so honored, Pastor Bert, Pastor Shanae, Pastor Pearson, Pastor Blessing, for an opportunity such as this. I'm like, whoa. When my husband broke it down to me this week that, hey, you're preaching at the Vault, I was like, oh, really? Is that so? Am I prepared for this? And I'm like, if the Holy Spirit is with me, I know I can do this. So I'm so excited. And on that note, I'd like to honor my husband. I don't know where he is, but hello, husband. Happily married for 3 months and a couple of days. So thank God for really that journey. Okay, I'm excited. It's really going to be an incredible service. And even as I'm about to share, I really, really pray, you know, and as I was praying for this message, it's something that God, like I said, has been speaking to me about, and I really hope that he will speak to you about this issue as well, okay? So I've realized that for the longest time, I've carried a mindset, a mentality of just being a part of the crowd, right? Just being a part of the crowd, just attending church, but God at some point had to reveal to me the power of being a disciple. And this is a message that I want to share today. The difference between the mentality of being a crowd member versus being a disciple. Okay, so I hope you guys are ready. Make sure that you're taking notes. And on that note, I want to challenge you, right? I want to challenge you just to make sure that you guys are engaged and that you are really receiving and ready to partake in the word. I want you to take a piece of paper, okay? Or if you're one of those people who are bougie and you have smartphones, you can create a table in your notes, okay? But I need you to take a piece of paper and draw a line in the middle, okay? You got that. Just a line in the middle. Draw a line in the middle, okay? And then on the one column, make your topic crowd. And then the next column, make your topic disciple. You guys got that? You good? You ready to go? Oh, come on. You ready to go? Okay. All right. Let's go. Let's go then. So my key scripture for today, which is something that Pastor Bert and has been sharing about. He's been sharing about teaching, preaching, healing. And as I read further in that scripture, it spoke about, you know, there are sheep, many sheep, but less shepherds. And that's what God is trying to achieve here. That's the mission of God, to make sure that shepherds are raised, disciples are raised, and that really the mission will really continue on forward, where we will walk in the character of God and what God has called us to do. And it reads in the book of Matthew chapter 9 and verse 35 to 38, it says, then Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion. Somebody say compassion. He was moved with compassion because they were weary and scattered, like sheep having no shepherd. Somebody say shepherd. There were sheep having no shepherd. And then verse 37 says, then he said to his disciples, the harvest is truly plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord of God, we thank you for this word. We thank you, Lord of God, for the scripture. Heavenly Father, may you really bless my lips as I'm about to preach. Your Lord, Holy Spirit, go before me and help me to speak accurately concerning your word. Help me, O Heavenly Father, Lord of God, to be accurate, that even even to those who are receiving, prepare their hearts, Lord God, that your word may fall on their hearts, that they may really have hearts that are ready to bear, that are ready to receive the seed, that they may be fruitful, and that they may reap 100-fold. We pray, Holy Spirit, may you be with us, Lord God, be in our midst, and help us, Lord God, to receive and be transformed and be changed in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so quickly, I'm going to define crowd and disciple, right? So a crowd, in this verse that I just read right now, it does mention the word crowd, and the Greek word for it, oh, I feel so special now. The Greek word for this, okay, is oklos. Somebody say oklos. Oklos, right? That means crowd. We are not oklos, right? In this building, to those who are streaming, God's mission is to really transform us from just being a part of the crowd to becoming the disciples. And we're going to chat a little bit about that. So a crowd is a multitude, is the common people. It's just a numerous amount of people, and you can be a part of that crowd. And then a disciple, you know this definition. Pastor Bert has always taught this, the one who follows Christ with the intent of becoming like him. That is a disciple. The one who follows Jesus Christ with the intent of becoming like him. You guys got that? All right. Okay. Let's continue on. So I'm going to mention to you guys just five characteristics, right? Five characteristics that define, that describes more of what a crowd is and what a disciple is. And this is why I needed you guys to draw that line in the middle and have the two columns next to each other. I need you to honestly be honest with yourself, right? Look at where you're at and write down for yourself if any of these characteristics identify you. Write down on which side you fall. Is that easy enough? You guys can do that? You can do that. Okay, great. Let's do this. Right. Characteristic number one of a crowd. A crowd is focused on their own need, right? They're focused on their own need. This is why they find themselves in a place where they're emotional, weary, distressed, scattered, depressed, whatever it might be. But then a disciple is focused on the need of others. Okay. You guys got that? Write down what most describes you. Are you a disciple or are you a crowd? Are you a person who is concerned about their needs, or are you a person that's concerned about the needs of others? There's a scripture in the book of Matthew chapter 6 and verse 31 to 33. And this is well known, guys. I'm sure all of you guys have heard this scripture somehow. And it reads, therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows what you need. He knows that you need all these things. He's aware of what you need. But therefore seek the kingdom of God at first and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. You don't have to be in a place where you're concerned about your needs, where you are super anxious about, what am I going to eat next? I was going in. Oh, there we go. All right. You don't have to be a person that's really concerned about, what am I going to eat? What am I going to wear? You know, what's the next style? Do I have the shoes? Do I have the fillers? One, two. Can you guys hear me? There we go. Okay. So we don't have to be a people who are concerned about our needs, and we don't have to really just consistently look at where we're at. And if you look also in the context of the Bible, the crowd, the people constantly went to Jesus. They crowded him for the sake of receiving. Most of them really wanted to just receive the teaching, to receive the healing. And all of us have been at that place. Even I have been at that place. There comes a time where you are a part of church and you are invited into church and you are a part of the crowd as it is. Some of you might be even new here, and you receive the word and you hear the word. But this is what's also important. God wants to raise you, not just from a place of just receiving this word and just being at a place of receiving whatever ministers to your needs, that eventually it will transform your heart, that you may meet the needs of others, that you may help others so that they may really grow in their purpose. And so really, this is what's very important concerning having a mindset of a crowd and having a mindset of a disciple. And I believe that whether you're new or not here at the vault, that God can really transform you. That line in the middle that you drew in the paper, it represents Jesus Christ, that he can really bring about a transformation and transition you from just being a part of whatever's happening here, in the building here, where you're streaming there, that God will really raise you to be a part of the kingdom, to really have an insight, to really know the mysteries concerning the things of the kingdom, that you may really be fruitful in all that you do. All right, that's the first characteristic. Characteristic number one, the crowd are the sheep. In bulls, oh no, that's a goat, right? The crowds are the sheep. And like we read in the scripture just now, really, they are like sheep without shepherd. Right? And there's also a verse as well that really touches my heart. And, you know, this verse was one of the founding verses that really assisted me and helped me in my faith concerning believing in Jesus Christ. And it reads in the book of John 10, verse 11, it says, I am the good shepherd and I know my sheep. Jesus knows his sheep. And I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for my sheep. Right? Jesus lays down his life for his sheep. And verse 16 as well, I love this. It says, even to the other sheep, which I have, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, to them as well also I must bring, that they will hear my voice and that they will be one, and they will be one as a part of my flock, and I will be one as their shepherd. And so really, the context of this scripture, which for me, you know, like I said, being a crowd is not necessarily a negative thing. There has to be a time where you really seek and you're really hungering and you really want to be in the presence of God and you really want to be in a place where you want to learn more about Jesus. You want to hear. You've heard of this Messiah. You've heard about what's happening at the vault. You've heard about what's happening in church and so on and so forth. And so you do come and you sit and you learn and you are his sheep. And to some, it might not seem like it, but it is guaranteed that even to those, you know, who are not back there in the day, who are following him, who are physically with Jesus, Jesus does say, and to the other, which who, you know, he has gone before us, even to us, we have that blessing of, you know, being his sheep. But I love how also in the scripture that we just read in the book of Matthew, that's not where it ends, that God can really transition you from just sheep to being shepherd. Lord have mercy. That can only happen through the power of the Holy Spirit, where really you tap into the, you know, the purpose of God and the will of God, that there are many sheep, right? There are many sheep. There are many sheep who might be streaming, and there are many sheep who are sitting here, and there are many sheep as well who are part of the other services, but are they shepherds? Can you honestly say to yourself, I am a shepherd? Can you honestly say to yourself, I am a shepherd, I am a leader, I am one who is called by God, and I am one who's appointed by God to teach, to preach, and to heal, right? God, Jesus has called us not only to just, you know, see what he did, but he wants us to partake in what he was doing. He wants us to be those disciples. He wants us to be a people who are intimate, who follows him, which leads me to the next characteristics. A crowd, characteristic number three, a crowd is a trend follower, right? A trend follower, but a disciple is a true follower. Did you guys catch that? A disciple is a true follower. See, a crowd, a person who has a mindset of a crowd, they follow, like, for example, back in the day, right, when Jesus began to pursue his ministry and to really go about teaching, preaching, healing, as we've read in the scripture. When Jesus went about doing all of that, many crowds gathered because they were so flabbergasted. They were like, oh my gosh, this guy's healing the sick. This guy's, you know, he's out here touching people and there are miracles and there are crazy things that are happening. A lot of people did follow and a lot of people, you know, followed him for the sake of, ooh, there's a vibe happening. There's Jesus around. Jesus has become a part of whatever. And you might find yourself in that today, that you have fallen into just a trend of really getting in to the presence of the Lord. Just the trends of just being here Friday evening and we see you next week Friday and the next Friday, but nothing is changing and nothing is growing. You're just witnessing what God is doing in other people's lives. But I believe that it is a time where you witness what He's going to do in your life, transforming you from just being a trend follower to being a true follower. What is a true follower? It is somebody who really follows with that intent of becoming. Right? Follows with the intent of learning, of growing, that you may really be empowered, not only for yourself, but be empowered to really do what He did and to do it effectively. And some of us catch ourselves. And when I say some of us, I'm preaching to myself. Sometimes I may catch myself in a place of having that crowd mentality where it's all about, okay, I'll go through with the motions. I'll make sure that I'm a part of church. I'll make sure that I'm in the vault life, and I'll make sure ABSC. But even though I am here, is God really working in my life to an extent where I can walk on a day-to-day basis, boldly saying I am pursuing His will. I am pursuing His purpose. I am truly following Him. I am intimate with Him. And not just, yeah, I came to the vault life, and I signed the screening stuff, and I was a part of this crowd, and I went back home, and it was a great vibe. But I believe that God really can transform. You are not just here because you're just here. Those who are streaming, you're not just here by mistake. Do not be here either by religious duty, but really be here to connect, that God may really transform our hearts and help us to step further into His purpose. And I want to read the scripture to you guys once again. Lots of scriptures. I need to back up everything I say with scripture. Okay. And it says here in the book of Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13 to 14. It says, there are many. Many enter through the narrow gate, because the wide gate and broad path is the way that leads to destruction. Nearly everyone chooses that crowded road. Most of us choose this crowded road. Most of us choose this comfort way. But I believe today that really this is the road that we ought to take, the one that is narrow, the narrow gate, the difficult way that leads to eternal life, so that but a few of them only find this way. And really, this is the context of the scripture, that to live for Jesus Christ is a sacrifice. And most of you might be surrounded even by friends who don't even believe. But I'm sure even in the context of where you are, the culture of where you are, there are a lot of people who don't even see church as cool, as necessary, as, you know, whatever it might be. I don't know about you, but when I was in high school, like, to be someone that stood firm for the Lord was just weird. It was just weird. It was not accepted. It was just, who are you? Whom's are you? Who do you think you are? That's how it was. It's like, you know, like, who are you to come preach Jesus, Jesus, Jesus? And it's all boring. And that is the context of this world. But as a disciple, I had to learn. I'm not going to be a part of the crowd, pushed around by what people say. But I will stand firm concerning the kingdom of God. I will be bold concerning preaching the gospel. And this is what gets me here. This is what gets me here, because God is really faithful, guys. God is really faithful to help you, to help you to grow, to help you to become a disciple. A true follower. I had to take a narrow road, one that did not seem popular, one that did not seem like it was likable, one that did not seem like it was worthy. I had to take that narrow road. And this is what gets me here. A leader, a person who's really passionate concerning the things of God, a person who really wants to see many disciples being made in all the nations. And many people might think, but what's so special about that? What is so special about that? The reward is not necessarily what you get here on earth, but it's what you really work on, what you build on, the goal, what you're running towards is the reward in heaven. One day I really want to stand before the Lord and really have Him say those words, well done, my good and faithful servant. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Not my good preacher, my pretty person, my whatnot. Well done, my good and faithful servant, because you have been accurate concerning the will. You have been making disciples. All right? Fourth characteristic, and I'm almost done. Fourth characteristic, right? Clueless. A crowd is clueless. a crowd is clueless. You can sit here in church listening, but you're not hearing. You're not hearing. It's not tapping in, you know? It's not hitting that thing, right? You can really be a person that is seated in here, but a disciple is one who has vision. It is a person who really taps into the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And only God, only the Holy Spirit can really work, do that work in your life if you are willing. If you would say, Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you and I will become all that you have called me to be. And so I wanted to read to you guys the book of Mark chapter 4 and verse 10. It says, this is after he taught the parable of the sower, right? And he taught to the multitudes. He taught to a crowd. Just like I'm doing now. He taught to the multitudes. He taught to a crowd. But it says here, but when he was alone, those around him with the 12, it wasn't just the 12, but those who really went for him, right, after, they asked him about the parable. And he said to them, to you, it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. To you. But to those who are outside, all things come in parables. And so this is why that scripture says as well, which is a reference from the Old Testament. It says, seeing they may see and not perceive, right? Hearing they may hear and not understand, lest they should turn and their sins be forgiven them. This is what really can qualify you to tap into that place, to really be in that place where God can do a work in your life, to transform that crowd mindset, right? You don't have to be a part of the crowd who just leave after this, but may you be those who follow Jesus and want to learn that, hey, Lord, I hear you. I heard you preach about all these parables, all these stories, and I don't understand. So why? What was that all about? What is a parable? And he taught them. Really, to those who pursue him, to those who will be intimate with him, to those who are around him, who follow him with the intent of learning, to them would the mysteries of the gospel be revealed to you. Because there are many people in church. They have this title Christianity. They have this, I am God's child, whatnot, the hearts of God, whatnot. They have all these explanations saying they are Christians, you know? Part of church, attending, A, B, and C. But that's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. It's not what's happening here. It's what's happening out there. After you hear what you've heard, after you learn what you've heard, it's not about what is happening in here. It is about what is happening out here. Because as a part of a church, as a vault, we are not here. We are not here to just help you for being here. We're here to send you out so that you can be effective even in the out. You can be effective in the word. You can be effective in the things of the kingdom out there, touching people's lives and being that disciple, being a person who is a visionary, a person who sees just beyond their circumstances, a person who sees just beyond, you know, these confinements of the world, this I'm the vault and I'm a part of the vault and the vault life and we're part of a Twitter mob and we're hashtagging the vault and whatnot. But will you really be intimately a part of what God is doing? Not just what the vault, what God is doing on a mission to make disciples of all nations. All right. And my last point, my last characteristic, okay, I'm almost done, people. 5, right? A crowd comes and goes. A crowd, they come and then they go. Right? We know this. It happens. A lot of people get to a place where like, they're weary, but it's a lot, but discipleship. Is this for me? Is that for not? Yo, we're tired of hearing it, people. This is God's mission. It is a blessing to do the things of God. It is no curse. It is not weary. It is not tiring. This is a blessing. This is what energizes you. This is what really produces you. It doesn't mean that all of us must come Gugubanch here at 3C. It is where you're at. May you be a disciple. May you be an effective person that takes the gospel into their area. And I really was touched by, you know, this scripture. Well, time is running up, people. Ooh. It's my first sermon. I'm learning to keep time as well. Okay, but let me just share this with you guys. A disciple is truly somebody who follows sacrificially. A disciple is someone who follows sacrificially. I've made a whole lot of sacrifices to be where I am today. It didn't feel nice at some point to say, I'm not going to take the ways of the world. I'm not going to go there where everybody else is going. I'm not going to choose that path, but I'm going to choose Jesus, and I'm going to be solid in it, and I'm not going anywhere, because this is the best life to live. Winning souls and making disciples. Winning souls and making disciples. And today, really, I wanted each and every single person to really search their hearts. Where you at concerning your faith? You've heard all those characteristics. If you fall on the one side, more on the crowded side, I believe that today is really the time for you to witness a transformation of the Holy Spirit, a work that only Jesus Christ can do. If willing, would you come before Him and repent? If willing, would you come before Him and say, Lord, help me. Lord, help me. I need you. I find myself still having a crowd mindset, even though we've been in the church for the longest time. But one thing I know for sure is that the grace of the Lord is abundant, and that God can help you today. God can help you today, tomorrow, and forevermore, because His mercies are new every single day. And so I want us to stand together, and we're going to pray. We're going to pray. And to those who might find themselves, like I said, your list is heavily on the crowd side. Even though you've been a part of the church, you've been a part of what we do, do not go through the motions. Do not just come to the vault for the sake of coming to the vault. Do not just come here for the sake of being present, but allow God to work in and through your life, that He may transform you from just participating, being a part of the crowd, to being a part of the family. The family of God, to being a part of the purpose. I believe that this anointing is not for just the preachers and the pastors and the bishops and the whatnot, but it is for every single believer. If you would believe today, if you would believe as Jesus Christ has died from the cross for every single one of us, I believe that the blood of Jesus can really help you. The blood of Jesus can really strengthen you once more to position yourself to get ready to win souls and make disciples, because He has given unto us this command. He has given us unto us this commission. The disciples saw Him after the resurrection, and there He spoke to them. He spoke to them. He's like, hey guys, I'm here. And some of them even doubted, even though He was right there. They even doubted that this was Him. And He tells them, listen, all authority has been given to me. All authority. Therefore, go ye and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them my ways, all that I've commanded you. And behold, I will be with you. 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 He is with us now. Discipleship was not a back then thing. It was a now thing. It is a now thing. It is what God is what wants to achieve in and through our lives now. God wants every nation to be populated with disciples. Will you become one? Will you be one? And as we are discipled, we believe that God will really help us to disciple others. And we will continue to, with this commission, we will continue with this mission that He has given us. That we will not just be a part of the crowd. We will not just be a part of the people who are needy. But God will really transform us to be a people who will minister to the needs of others. And so right there where you are, just raise your hands unto the Lord. And we're going to pray and just seek for His presence. Seek for His love. Seek for His mercy. Seek for His grace in this moment. And repent. Repent. Repent and return back to Him. That our sins may be forgiven, and that really He will reveal to us the mysteries of this. The importance, the necessity, the purpose of becoming a disciple and making disciples. And Heavenly Father, you see us right there. You see us right here where we are. You see us, Lord God. You see what we are going through. You see what we are experiencing. You see what we are encountering, Lord God. And so we come before you, Lord, saying, help us, Jesus. Help us, Lord, where we've fallen short of your glory, where we've fallen short concerning this purpose of making disciples, of winning souls. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, that we may be accurate once again concerning the things of your kingdom. And right there with where you are, with your own words, speak to him. Speak to him. Speak to him. Allow him to minister to your heart. Holy Spirit, Lord, we pray. Convict us, Lord of God. Convict us. Position us once again to really become all that you've called us to become. Oh, we need you, Jesus. Apart from you, we cannot even do this. This is beyond us. Apart from you, we cannot even do this. And so we need you, Holy Spirit. We need you, Lord. We need you, Jesus. And right now, I want to pray for those who are just like, oh, but this message, I hear you, Euphracia. I don't even know who Jesus is. I don't even understand. I have all these, you know, conceptions of who he is, but I don't even understand. Today, God can really open up your eyes. Open up your eyes. You don't have to be clueless. You don't have to be confused today. You don't have to be in a place where you feel like you were excluded from what I just spoke to you about. And I want to introduce you to Jesus Christ right there where you are. On a count of three, if you want to receive Jesus in your life, if you want to partake on this mission, if you want to partake of this great commission and be ready to walk hand in hand with the Lord Jesus Christ to see the power of God manifest in your life, I want to give you an opportunity to give your life to Jesus. And on a count of three, just say, yes, Lord. Say, yes, Lord. In your heart, just say, yes, Lord. I receive you. One, two, three. Hallelujah. And even to those who might have been disciples all along, but you feel like you've fallen short. You feel like you haven't met the requirements. You feel like you cannot even do this. You feel like you cannot even follow. You cannot even teach. You cannot even preach. It's just too much. It's beyond you. I want to tell you today, it's for all of us. And as we get back into the presence of Jesus Christ, he will saturate you with his love. He will saturate you with his purpose once again. And you will be empowered to go and love as he has loved you. And so I want you to pray this prayer with me. If you said yes to the Lord, say with me, Heavenly Father, I need you in my life. Oh Lord, I've sinned. I've messed up. And so I come to you, Lord of God. I know apart from you, I cannot do this. I cannot change myself. But with you, Jesus, I have eternal life. I am forgiven of my sins. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you that nothing and no one can separate me from your love. Amen. Hallelujah. To those who've received Jesus, congratulations, amen and amen. It is done. And get excited. Get excited for what God is going to do in and through your life. Get excited to be a part of God's family. Get excited to go through this mission together, not just alone, but here we are for it. We are for making disciples. We are for doing what God has called us to do. Hallelujah. Are you guys ready? Are you ready to populate the nations with disciples? Are you ready to go to the next level as a disciple? Hallelujah. Exciting, exciting. All right, guys, we've come to the end of it, right? It's not necessarily the end because guess who's back? The Josh is back. The Josh is back and we're about to partake in the after party. So right there where you are, get up and get ready to dance. Let's go.
You don't know. You just woke up feeling dangerous today. Guys, there's no place like the Vote Live. No, listen to me carefully. It's hashtag the Vote Live brew. We're gonna see you next week, same time, same place. The Vote Live, yes sir. Yes sir. Yes sir. Good. Okay, no, wait, put me back. Put me back. My mic.